Welcome to Munch UK and the live stream of the new venture, this online digital platform that Munch UK has set up for all of us. This is the brainchild of Meera Kaushik and her team, and I'd like to thank all of them for inviting me onto this very wonderful platform. It's a strange time, as we know, we are all stuck at home because of coronavirus and not with the best resources as well. We don't have access to many of the things that we usually have. So I'd like to say a very big thank you to Meera. I'd like to say a very big thank you to Ambika Mohan Kucheria and to Subbalakshmi, to Suhani and to Vidya Patel and everyone else who's working on this very fabulous venture. I think, I truly believe that it's going to be a historical archive for the longest time after this, once we are all through and we get back to our busy lives of performing, of getting on with what we do, the busyness of life, but this will remain. And I think it is something that we'll all look back to and cherish, because it's not just the usual life that we do, not the usual performing, but also the life stories behind all of us. And I've really been so touched and so inspired by what I've heard in the last 4 days on Munch UK. So yeah, to begin my story, my name is Monisha Patil Bharadwaj. I was born in Mumbai, and that's where I grew up. My dance training started really when I was about 4 or 5. And I used to have a dance teacher come home to teach me. How privileged is that? I also took some lessons in school. So my dance teacher at home used to teach me Bharatanatyam. And in school, we had lessons in Kathak. So I learned a little bit of both. Didn't take it too seriously then. It was just something that children learned and I was part of that. I think the biggest moment in my dance life was actually something my parents did. And they probably saw that I had an interest in dance and they took me to my Guruji's school. And for that, I'm eternally grateful. I studied with Guru Kalyan Sundaram Pillai of Rajarajeshwari Bharatanatya Kala Mandir for 25 years. And I think that moment when they took me there was what really shaped everything that I am today as a dancer. My Guruji gave me not just training, he gave me time and he gave me belief and trust. And I think I'm so proud that all the hallmarks of the Rajarajeshwari school, which is scintillating choreography, lyrical abhinaya, brilliant footwork, I could showcase all of that, all of those in the years to come. And for that, I feel truly blessed. My dance school also gave me the opportunity to work with some of the most fabulous dancers. And I was able to share a stage with great dancers like Vani Ganapati, Meera Dhanu, Viji Prakash, Lata Pada, who is still my dear, dear, dear friend. And it was a time that I think I learned so much, but also felt so special to be in that position where I could, be in the company of people like this. My mother, when I was quite young, became the editor of Femina, which was India's biggest women's magazine. And through her work, my family got to meet so many different artists, dancers, musicians, painters. And I think I got so much inspiration from them as well. There are some stories I'll share with you. So one time, my mom was interviewing Pandit Ravi Shankar Ji at home. And it was the end of the interview. He was leaving. And at the same time, I was leaving to go to college, which was sixth form. We called it college. And Pandit Ji said, "Shall I drop you?" And I said, "Okay, thank you." And he took me to college. And I can't tell you how popular I was in college that day. Every single person came and asked me, "Was it really Pandit Ravi Shankar who dropped you?" And to me, that was something that happened often. And I don't say this in a kind of arrogant way. It was just part of our lives. We met so many people. Sunil Kothari Ji used to be with us so much and sharing his research. It was an amazing time. Another story that I remember was that my Guruji, after my Arangetram when I was 17, he choreographed for me a whole solo performance on the works of Purandara. And we performed them at various places, including Delhi, Bangalore, Mumbai. And I remember going to listen to Pandit Bhimsen Joshi, someone I truly admire and whose Purandara works I used to listen to also quite a lot. And Panditji looked at me and said, oh, you know, you're the girl who's performing Purandara in Bharatanatyam, so well done. And for me, that was a humbling moment for someone as great as Pandit Bhimsen Joshi to know that I was doing such a thing and to acknowledge me. It was a lesson in humility, and I just realized how much artists can, even at the pinnacle of their success, be so humble. Pandit Jasraji was a great friend of my Guruji. He would often come to class and he would tell us how to improve our dance styles, how to do practice, how much sadhana we needed. So it was a time of lots and lots of interactions. I was also involved with the NCPA in a few ways. So of course I used to perform there, but also as a very young dancer, they would invite us to compare shows. Now in those days, dance shows were compared. Unlike today when dancers talk about their own pieces, in days gone by, there used to be a compare, and I had the opportunity to compare for great dancers like Sonal Mansingh and Padma Subramaniam, and I saw them at such close quarters from the wings, could learn technique, could learn stagecraft, and for that, again, it was a very magical time in Mumbai. But all thanks to my Guruji, Guru Kalyan Sundaram, who, without whom, you know, I think my life would have been very different and completely underwhelming. Also, with my mother's work, there was a lot of the glamour world, Indian films, modeling, the Miss India shows with which my mother was involved. But I think my dance training was so intense, and many of you will identify with this, 8 hours, 9 hours of dance training, performance, that there was no attraction for me to go into a world of glamour in that way. I did do some modeling. I modeled for Air India and for Sun Silk and for Vimal Saris, I think it was, but there was no attraction for me to go into films. And I think also it was because, looking back, I think I was probably quite a shy girl. It didn't show on stage, and many of us will also agree, I think, that when you're on stage, you're a different person, and in real life, you're different. So I think in real life, I was quite a shy person. Side by side with my dance, I also trained to be a chef. I went to the Catering College in Mumbai, IHMCTAM, which is fondly called Catering College Dadar. And I spent 3 years there. I also did a degree in history. I did a BA in history. And then shortly after that, I moved to England. When I moved to England, it was a completely different scene. And of course, the first thing I missed when I came to England was having my guru here all the time. And I think, you know, many of us feel that when you are constantly in the company of your guru and in training, and there's that correction, you want to please your guru so much, you do your best. And then to come to another country where you're practicing in your own living room, you're motivating yourself every day. I think that was the hardest thing for me, not having his presence and his blessings all the time, face to face. I started teaching fairly soon after I came to England, and this was one way to keep in touch with the dance, to have regular contact with it and to do my own practice. It was also, I remember a time in England when the dance world was small. In fact, I think it still is, looking at all the posts that have already happened on Munch UK. It seems like we know so many dancers, and the world of dance seems not very big even now. In those days, it was even smaller. There was no internet. And we met at performances, we met through the academy who would do so many workshops. There was the Commonwealth Institute in Kensington, and we would often do workshops there. But my dance career in the UK, I think, is punctuated by a few companies. And one of them was the Shobhana Jai Singh Dance Company. I worked with Shobhana in the late 80s and early 90s when their company was just starting. We worked on projects like the early projects, configurations, making of maps, Byzantium, and I met some very fabulous dancers who are still my good friends, Meera, Gokul, Vidya, Tirunarayan, and my very soul sisters, Subhadra, Sudarshan, and Meena Rajarani, who remain my good friends. We toured for so many months every year. We went all over Europe, we went to Canada, and it was a very intensely dance life of practicing choreography, touring, and At the same time, I was also doing quite a bit of classical work. I work with Anup Biswas company, and we did a project called Traveling Festival of India, where again I met so many people who have remained my friends and my dearest friends at that. Vicky England, who curated the whole project and toured with us, she was our tour manager, one of my best friends even today. Sujata Banerjee is still one of my dearest friends. Sanjeevani Datta, who I meet not that much, but I remember with great fondness. And it was a time when there was much happening in the dance world here. Most of us had been trained in India. There were not too many people who were completely UK trained. I think it was only Nina at the time who was trained at the Bhavan. But most of us came with different styles. And I think the exciting thing for us also was to be able to find the bits that matched and the bits that didn't match, like the Tirman Adavus, which everyone did differently and everyone said that their bit, the way was the right one. So it was a time of great sharing. There are some moments that punctuate this time again, and I think one of them was working with Pratap Pawarji. We danced together at the opening of the Nehru Gallery at the V&A Museum, and this was in the presence of Her Majesty the Queen. So it was quite a special moment, and I remember that also with great fondness. It was, time of being young, of touring, of performance, and I think that when I look back at that time, it was a time to me of great privilege of being at really in, you know, some of the best venues in London, in the UK, in Europe, and I always think that, you know, I was completely blessed to have been in that position. In the 90s, the early 90s I got married, and then shortly after that I moved back to India for a bit. My children were born, and then in the early 2000s I had a little bit of a disaster as my marriage broke down. Now this was the time when I had to escape from it, and things were not very good. People who've spoken these last few days, Akash, Suhani, Suraj, and Divya Kasturi, we have all spoken about how the dance is spiritual, and there's a soul connection. I had, as all of us do, so many objects that are what we call our sacred objects. I think our dance costumes, our music, notes, photographs. And at that time I lost all of these, and I never had access to them again. So a big chunk of my dance life ended there. A little request, if any of you have photographs of us dancing together or of me somewhere, then I'd be so ever grateful if you send them to me, because I have none. When Munch UK asked me to share some photographs or videos, I don't have any from the past. So please do share them with me, and I'd be most delighted. Coming to how the dance then evolved, it was also at the time when I was here as part of Shobhna's company, I worked with Chandralekha, who came over to do Speaking of Shakti. And some of you who were part of that production will remember how much our physicality was challenged. We had been trained, and very well trained as dancers, to stand upright, to think of our core. And suddenly all that was being lost. We were supposed to give up that standing pose, fall to the floor in a graceful manner without getting hurt, and also use the spine in so many different ways. So it was a chance to learn a new kind of movement, and we all enjoyed it in as much as one can enjoy a difference of style, where there's quite a lot of physicality involved and quite a lot of chance of also injuring oneself. So I think moving on from there, we came to the point where, because of the situation that happened with the breakdown, I also found that suddenly I became completely responsible for two young people. My children were very little, and I became the sole breadwinner in the house. It was also when I think my time and resources were completely focused on the children, and I had to find ways to make our lives safe and happy and workable. And this is when I started Cooking with Monisha, which is my cooking business. This was started 15 years ago. And as the director of Cooking with Monisha, I write books. Here are some of them, and I've written 16, I think. My newest book, which is Indian in 7, has won the Gourmet World Cookbook Award 2020 for being one of the top three Indian cookery books in the world. Many of my books won me awards and did very well. We publish now in 8 different languages, so and I'm currently also working on my next one. Through Cooking with Monisha, I've done lots of TV and radio and worked on ITV for programs like Inside the Factory, BBC Food and Drink, and Radio 4, the food program. I've had the opportunity to work with very fabulous partners, and for that I'm ever grateful. I've worked with Kew Gardens on healing ingredients. I've worked with Borough Market many times, with the British Council, developing a talk for them on how the British fell in love with curry. I worked with SOAS, University of London, on a series of lectures on the history of India through its food. Last year I was invited on a cookery cruise to be guest speaker on Indian food. And there are lots and lots of different opportunities. Every month there's something new that comes up. I think the purpose and the focus of my work in the last 15 years, and the driving force really, has been my two children, Arush and India. I think without them it would be very hard to motivate myself the way I have done and to achieve what I have, because there would be not the same kind of purpose. I think it would be harder for me to go to heights. I think it was more important for me to be a role model to them and to also show myself and show them that when adversity strikes, it's not the end. It can move into something else, and you know, one can be a winner rather than a victim. So that has been my philosophy, and lots of my work has depended on this philosophy. They've been there with me throughout, with humor, with sometimes criticism, but yeah, they've been lovely to have, and they're still lovely to have. Cooking with Monisha, of course, is something that I do all the time. I still teach dance once a week, and for that, again, I'm grateful to my students, some of whom hopefully are listening. They keep me rooted to the dance and engaged and connected, so it's not something that has completely gone out of my life. I also think that, you know, today there's not, it's not a world where we do just one thing. There are so many things out there that we can achieve, and so many different things. There are people that, you know, have done photography with medicine and archaeology with dentistry, and I think it's a lovely world to be in, where there's so many different ways of expressing creativity. I've been able to do it through both my dance work and through my cooking work, and I think both are equally creative in slightly different ways. People have asked me, and this is a question that I ask myself sometimes, I have asked through the years, do I miss performing? Being such a prolific performer and being on stage so much, we all know that we get used to the footlights, we miss the wings. And I've asked myself this question, do I miss performing? And my answer has been, no, I don't think so. And there are two reasons for this. One is that I think I had my fill of performing. It was a charmed life. I had the best opportunities. I worked with the best people. And I really don't have any regrets about missing out on anything. I didn't. I did everything that I wanted. And secondly, I think also my next career, my cooking career, gives me the opportunity to perform so much on stage, through demonstrations. Sometimes it's demonstrations with hot pans and sharp knives to 15,000 people. At the Birmingham Mela a couple of years ago, there were 15,000 people. So I had to draw on all the skills I had as a performer to be any good. So there are plenty of opportunities. Also in my classes, I run about 4 classes a week at Cooking with Monisha. And in every class, I try and channel all my energies and all my experience of dance performance so that I can keep my students engaged, focused, interested, and also I hope that they will leave my kitchen with a little bit more love, with a little bit more curiosity, a little bit more understanding about India and its culture through the medium of food. Now, I think I was quite keen to answer questions, and I should have said at the start that please post your questions at the end, but I think I would like to give some time to questions now. So if anyone has any questions, ask me. India is going to ask the questions for you, so if you post them, and I hope you're curious about something.
Please let them know when you do a demo of Kothimbir Vadi.
Okay, someone has asked for a recipe. I almost wanted to read out one of my recipes, but I thought, no, probably it's better if you buy the book. I will try and do some demos of recipes. Follow me on Instagram and you'll see some of my recipes there.
What's your favorite dish?
My favorite dish? I've always said that my favorite dish is something that someone else cooks for me. I'm the major cook in my world, and so when someone else cooks for me, my children cook for me, and I'm grateful for that, that becomes my favorite dish. Is that it?
There's a lot of love.
Thank you. India says there's a lot of love being sent, and thank you for that. Thank you so much. I will be answering questions afterwards that you post. So if you can't think of anything right now, then please post your questions and I will spend time this evening answering them.
Yeah. Are you still giving cookery lessons during the lockdown?
I have tried a couple of Zoom lessons. They have worked really well, except I think that food is such a sensory thing that unless you can smell and taste, it's not the same. You know the thing, sometimes when you've been in a situation where you've had the best, you know, like being, for example, for me, the best in my dance was dancing in front of my guru. Nothing can replicate that. And similarly in cooking also, when I find that, you know, I've had a class full of students and we're engaging, we're tasting, we're talking about food and smelling and looking at how the spices change, nothing can replicate that. So I wait for classes to resume on the other side of the lockdown, but of course I know that my business will have to change in some ways going forward.
Time management secret.
Time management secret, don't sleep. I think, you know, this is one thing I always say to my children as well. If there's one thing you learn from me, it's time management. And it's, again, I think, to do with, you know, good training in dance. We've always managed to, you have to follow rhythm, you have to finish on time, you have to enter the stage on time, you've got to be traveling and arrive, you've got to be ready for rehearsals, you know. So I think these things come with training all through your life from a very young age, and it's, you don't even learn it as time management. It's something that comes organically and naturally through everything else you learn.
When have you performed with India and how was the experience?
So every year my students and I perform in a showcase. It's an annual showcase, and India has been learning with me also. Intermittently, because she's been away at university for a few years. But yes, I absolutely adore performing with her. And usually our show or our performances in the summer. This year, of course, it won't happen. And I look forward to performing with her again.
Where and what was your favorite dance performance?
Very hard to say. There's one. There's so many that were absolutely fabulous. I think Arangetram would stand out for me because it was the first time I was on stage alone. For 2 hours, and the amount of work that went into that, we all know this. I probably haven't worked that hard at a performance since then, or it doesn't seem like, maybe because it was the first time I did it.
Where do you get inspiration for your recipes?
Here. I'm constantly thinking food. And everywhere I go, I'm thinking food. And it's sometimes a sad thing, because I think my dancing is not going in parallel with my food work. I should be dancing as much as I cook so I can keep fit. But the food overtakes, and I think about it all the time. So my inspiration is all from everywhere.
What are your thoughts on maintaining positive attitude during the lockdown?
I think, you know, if you think of being, I think of being very grateful. I have a lovely safe house to be in. I have friends and family around who I can talk to. We are privileged in that we have technology to communicate with. And also, you know, I always have thought that if you keep life simple, life becomes happy. Wanting too much of everything has never given anyone happiness. And I think if I keep my wants, needs, wishes simple, I'm able to be more grateful for everything that I have.
Is there any signature adavu of Raja Rajeshwari's school of dance?
Sorry, is there any signature?
Adavu.
Oh, the Tirmana adavu, which is, I'm going to do a little demonstration if I can. So many dancers will know that, you know, the Tirmana adavu is the one that is so changeable in different styles. But the way that we would do it is starting from here, going all the way around, coming back and down. So unlike some of the other dancers that I've worked with and we've compared notes, I think it's a little bit different. And I think this is the one I would say was the one that we noticed as being different amongst the styles.
Would you consider doing dance lessons or Bollywood workout online?
I do already do dance lessons because we have continued our Wednesday lessons on Zoom. It's not as good as being physically with my students because I can't correct them or they can't see me as well, I think. But we have not stopped our lessons. So since the lockdown, we have been meeting every week and doing our lessons. I think we are at the end of our time. Thank you so much for joining me, and tomorrow at 6 o'clock, you'll be able to interact with our next artist, Veena Rampal, and I hope you enjoyed the session, and I look forward to answering any more questions. Thank you so much. Namaste.